What's going on, everybody? Welcome to this week's episode of the Reseller Greatness Podcast. We have a tremendous guest on today. I'm going to be honest, Tom. I was always afraid to ask you to be on the podcast because I didn't know if you would do it. But we have Tom here, and Tom is a very big thinker. I'm very straightforward, black and white. Tom, he paints in many different colors, and I absolutely I have a lot of respect for that because I'm not able to go in a lot of the directions that you are able to go in, Tom. And I listen to all the discussions that you guys have on the media call and just your outside the box thinking, your huge mentality. I have a lot of respect for that because I went huge, but what you do kind of makes me look like an amateur, my friend. So, Tom, tell us a little bit about yourself, how you started selling, who you are, how you got here, and then we'll get into the rest, but thank you very much for joining us today.
That's all right. Thank you for having me, and thanks for that introduction. That's it's always nice to hear that from other people in the resale community that they appreciate what you do, and they can see the sort of effort you put in. As far as how I got into resale, I'm 41 years old now. I started when I was 15. I used to collect graffiti magazines, and I was very sort of interested in art and street art and that sort of stuff. And what I used to do was, so these magazines were quite expensive, and in order to afford them, what I'd do is I'd buy small bulk lots of them, 10 copies of the same title, keep one, sell the rest, use that money from the sale of the nine to pay for that one for my collection. And so I was able to amass a pretty big collection at a young age doing that. And then I got into sort of a bit of retail arbitrage, and I'd go to stores in Sydney, which is 3 hours away from my house, and I'd buy magazines and I'd bring them back to my city, and I'd put them in music shops on consignment. And so I was doing that at an early age and sort of just ramped it up from there. But for a long time, the business was revolved all around art supplies, and it did so for a good 10 years. And slowly but surely, I sort of got into other categories. So I'd go to garage sales and op shops, and I'd just buy stuff and then flip it. And it didn't really matter what it was. If it was interesting, if I saw I could make money on it, that's what I was looking at. And then from there, I thought I need to get a bit more organized about this. And I always had visions when I was operating out of my parents' house, out of my bedroom. I always had visions of having a warehouse and really upscaling it to a massive degree. And I always thought, I'm spending 3 hours a day hand dressing labels for packages to go out. I'm like, there's got to be a better way. And we just sort of ramped it up from there. And the basically the position I was then and where I am now is basically when I was 15, the vision I had then is where I'm at now. The vision I've got now for the business is probably 5 years away, but the trajectory is like straight up. So I'm pretty happy with the way it's all gone. I've got a bunch of different warehouses. We've got a forklift. We've got a truck. I've got off-sider that's full-time. Then I've got a permanent part-time person, and then I've got a casual person, and we're looking at getting a few more in. So we've really scaled it up. And the way I scaled it was, I remember a quote from years ago. This guy said, "You don't have to come up with a $1 million idea. You need to come up with a $10 idea that you can replicate. Make sustainable, do it over and over again. You get to a certain point, and you basically get in some help and essentially clone yourself so you can do more and more." And that's sort of where we're at and where we've been for a while. We're trying to do a lot with few people. And I said to my guys a long time ago, I said, "Look, I can bring in more people, or I can pay you guys more money and essentially can work harder and work smarter." And so that's what we did. Paid them more money. And instead of getting a whole bunch of people in, I'm stuck with a really small, tight-knit crew. And I'm really proud of my guys, and I'm really happy with the crew. We have had a whole bunch of other people come through the business, like employees. So at one point I had seven people here. I was training five new people in 1 week, and it was an absolute nightmare.
Brutal.
Finding hardworking, loyal, trustworthy people, but you can give a key to the warehouse and you have no concerns at all, is really hard to find. So I'm really lucky with my guys. And I feel at this point I've got a responsibility. The company, the business comes first before me. And then essentially it's me, because without me there is it's not here. And then it's my guys. And that is the motivation. I sort of said to him a long time ago, I'm like, look, stick with me, and as it grows and increases, I'll bring you guys up as well. And I think that's the only way you can do it. It's not, I don't think it's right to come into a business like this and be selfish and only be out for yourself. If you've got people that are helping you, I feel you need to help them back. And so that's my passion has changed a bit. So my passion started off with graffiti magazines, and it's about me, it's about my collection, and it's progressed from there. And it's like, all right, well, I see a lot of holes in the market. I see a lot of problems. I want to solve problems, and I want to fill holes in the market. So a lot of the stuff I do now, we were the number one CD seller, and we'll have that title back in about 2 weeks. We dropped off a little bit. We became the number three bookseller. My girlfriend was the number three bookseller in Australia. Now she's number four. So I'm pretty happy about that. She's not, but I am. And what we're sort of looking at doing is, all right, if we're good at what we do and we're selling a lot of CDs, DVDs, books, some records, and then just occasionally other random things. I mean, I remember getting 30, I think it was 30 ambulance stretchers once, and they sold like hotcakes for a really good profit margin. I'm like, who would buy ambulance stretchers? But it was a lot of people that worked in what are they called? The mortuaries and the funeral homes. And so what I'm looking at in the business is, I'm like, all right, well, how can we solve problems for people, and what holes can we fill? So, and not just for other people, for ourselves as well. So an example of a solving a problem for someone else is there are some charitable groups that might do a book fair or book sale. And at the end of it, they don't know what to do with all the leftover books. And a lot of the time they're disposing of them, because a lot of the time they can't be recycled. And so we've gone in and negotiated arrangements, and we'll buy the whole lot and basically take it from them. And it's a solution for them, and they're getting income from it, and it's also good for us. It's been a double-edged sword, because we end up with a huge amount of stock. And we get no stock, and then all of a sudden we have a huge truckload arrive, and we're bogged down. We're trying to process it, and that's been a bit problematic, because you sort of need a consistent flow in and a consistent flow out. If you get these sudden ups and downs, it can muck you around a bit. So that's an example of solving a problem for someone else, solving a problem for ourselves. So selling the CDs, and we really like CDs because they're so small and compact, and you can fit a lot in a small space. And I think it's an underestimated market, especially when you look at the individual profit margins. So one of the problems we had was, we needed some machines to clean them, to take out scratches, to make the disc look like new again. And so we were buying these machines, and then we had some problems with the distributor. So they were coming from Japan. The distributor for Australia was in New Zealand, and it was a bit slow and difficult to get all the supplies in. So we went straight to Japan and said, all right, we want to become a distributor. And they're against it straight off the bat. They don't take us seriously. And they're thinking, no, we've got this one distributor, we're happy with them, and we'll stick with them. So what we did, we negotiated for ages. And this has been a deal going on for 18 months now. And we've had a bit of supplies from them. We've been over to Japan and met them. And we've got our first shipping container load coming from them in about a month and a half. And so what that does for us, we get the machines, the spare parts, and the cleaning supplies at the best price we can. We are also able to then sell the machines, the supplies, the spare parts to our competitors, And we're really well placed to do that because we use the machines every single day. So we know what works and what doesn't, and how you do things and what you do and what you don't do. So that'll be good for customers in Australia being able to get these machines from within Australia at a better price, quicker, and from someone that uses them every day. And it's also good from us for the point of view that we can see who's who in the zoo. We can see who the competitors are that are using the machines. And we can gauge who's doing a lot of volume based on how many supplies they're buying. So it almost feels like it's something a bit naughty. It almost feels like we shouldn't have that sort of intel coming in.
Right.
But yeah, it solves a problem for us. It's another income stream, and I think it will help a lot of resellers in Australia that want these machines as well.
Absolutely. So I've listened to hundreds of hours of you talk, and I enjoy listening to you talk. I enjoy listening to the thought process. I admire this huge picture that you're able to have, because like you said, like I already have a half page full of notes already, and we're already 10 minutes in, Tom. So like I love this. So your primary focus is CDs. You have 132,000 listings. You have a small crew. So you've talked about filling some holes. You have a small crew, very large exposure. You have the CDs. You're obviously taking massive action on every single thing you see. You're taking massive action. If you are having trouble getting the disc cleaning machines, you're flying to Japan, setting up your own distribution deal to be the distributor to all of Australia. Now you know who else needs disc cleaning machines, and you've even talked about maybe even wholesaling to the people that buy the disc cleaners from you. Like you're always five or six steps ahead. So I guess, how do you get to the point where you have 132,000 CDs? And this is nowhere near the top. Like, you're going to have hundreds of thousands of CDs. And you say it's an underutilized market. You're trying to fill holes in the market. How do you, as a company, as a staff, balance trying to really go to the throat of the CD market in Australia? And just so we get everybody on the same page, Australia is the size of the United States, has 26 million people. California has 39 million people. Texas has 30 million people. Florida has 22 million people. So it's the size of the United States, but your entire addressable market is Texas for us. So that is a little bit of a complexity for you that you have to navigate. Huge area, the population is as big as Texas. So how do you balance, though, by putting 110% of your focus and your attention and structure around CDs, but then also going on these tangents where if a book fair is finished, you take all the books? Because we saw the video with Mel. You guys had like 30 Gaylords of books. You talk about you did a fantastic deal with the stretchers. How do you balance? Because I think a lot of people have a lot of trouble balancing kind of like this extra credit stuff that looks appealing, and it kind of, like you said, mucks them up. How do you not lose focus on the core business of 132,000 products when every single day, I know every single day you can find something that's going to bring you this way?
We've got really good systems in place, and they're really they're old-fashioned systems, and they're proven. And a lot of it comes down to a level of organization of your warehouse space. So don't judge my warehouse operation by what you see in the background of my office. Like this is obviously a bit of a cluster, but in the areas where we pick from, it is meticulous. Like one of our business names is OCDs, OHCDS. And it's tongue in cheek saying that we've got OCD because we're that level of organization. Like it is neat and tidy. If I see a box like a little bit too out from a shelf, I'm
Same.
like, it's got to go back in a bit, you know?
Yes, sir.
So, and I figure, going back to when I was doing it by myself in my parents' house in my bedroom, and I'm hand addressing envelopes for 3 hours. And it's like, if I can't find something, it's a real problem. I learned very quickly that you've got to have good systems in place so you can quickly and easily process orders. So our sell-through rate is low because our prices are high, and we're not we're certainly not where we need to be. But with a small crew, with what we've achieved, I'm very proud. As far as where we pick from, our SKU system, it is designed to be quick and easy. And it's designed to be anyone can come in and you can tell them in 2 minutes how we do it and they're off and running.
Same. Big believer in that. Big believer in that too. Yep.
The more simplistic and lean your systems are, the better. The more money you're going to make. The less clutter you've got around, the quicker
Less
and
people you
easier.
need. Yep.
Exactly. The quicker and easier you can process things. So this year, at the start of this year, I came up with five goals for the year. And I said, right, there's a website project we've got to get on top of. I've got some health issues I've got to get on top of. We're currently getting sued by a supplier. Got to get on top of that. And it's just a mad distraction. You don't want to deal with that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And then there's a couple other things that revolve around getting on top of all our death pile, all our unlisted inventory. And the reason I said this at the start of the year, because in my mind, we'd need a full year to do that, because we have a lot of unlisted inventory.
I get it. It's an entire cruise ship. A cruise ship takes 7 miles to stop. It's not a dinghy at this point. You know, a dinghy you can stop and make a change. When I had a store size of 50,000 items, I needed a full year to make a change, implement a change. And you know what? You better be right on that implementation or that decision. Otherwise, everything is gone. Everything can sink. So, like, you really have to consider and spend a lot of time and put a lot of effort towards any sort of thinking or any sort of deviation from what you're doing, because otherwise, it can totally destroy everything that you have going on. So, like, when you talk on the media call, you speak the same language as me. So, like, sometimes, like, everyone will have an opinion. Tom, I get it. I get it, man. Like, I'm one of the few people that understand running a huge operation with a couple people. I get it. So you have been talking a lot about integrating a lot of technology into the business. You mentioned that a lot of your systems are old-fashioned. How do you mend both of those together? Because and I think it's a good question, because every eBay seller, to some extent, all of us, we have old-fashioned systems, whether it's a SKU, whether it's color-coded, however it is. Technology is coming every single day. We have AI, we have all of these things. And you've been trying to develop this technology where you can zip out listings in 10 seconds. What is the challenge of old-fashioned mending with technology?
I think it's quite easy for us in that regard because one of our old-fashioned systems is our SKU, right? So the three main products we deal with day in, day out, CDs, DVDs, books. So we've got three separate SKUs. For the CDs, it's C, and then it's five digits. So it's C00001, and it goes up from there. And we're up to C, I think about 1850. So we've got 1850 boxes of CDs. Each one holds 80 CDs in it.
And all of those are in order.
They're in order. Oh yeah, big
Okay.
time. So we started off doing alphabetical order and we got out of that real quick. That is a terrible, terrible thing to do. And that is, I n would never recommend that to anyone.
Let me ask you a question. I don't want to get you off track, but when you have all the boxes in order, how do you condense?
What we basically do is we'll walk around the warehouse, and this is how old-fashioned we are. We've got a bit
Sure.
of paper, and it's got a box number written on it, and then it says 30. So we know we can fit 30 standard size CDs in that box. And so literally all do is list them under that SKU, put them in a box, send them to the
Reuse the
photographer.
SKU.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Makes
So
sense.
our SKU is a bit different. Our SKU is really a location in the warehouse, and it's dedicated real estate for that stock. So the SKUs don't change per se; they just expand.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
And we found that's been the best system. And so when we print out our pick list, they're in SKU order. So we do books first, then we do CDs, then we do DVDs. We've got three separate people working on that, and they're in separate sections. So you don't get in each other's way. So you've got
Sure.
one person doing the DVDs, one on books, one on CDs. The books, we've only just started doing the books relatively recently, maybe 2 years ago. And the books, We haven't put a huge amount of time and effort into it, but we're seeing some good sales there, and we're seeing some really good returns. But we might only have 10, 15 book orders going out in the day, and we might have 60 CDs going out that day. So we'll do the book pick, or one person will do the book pick, and then they might start at the end of the CDs and work their way backwards while one person's working from the front.
Yeah.
But I think as far as the technology goes, we've been working on some website applications for 3 years now, and it's a real grind. And we've had a lot of bad luck with websites. Like, I paid someone to build a website. They were part of a company that I was also a part of, and they basically took my money and ran. And then we've had a few other people do a little bit of stuff here and there, but nothing really concrete. We're onto a really good crew now, or two good crews. One's in India and one's here in Australia. The Indian crew promised us the earth and said they could deliver on a big project. And the project was reverse e-commerce. And you go onto the website, you scan in a barcode, or you enter the title. We give you a valuation for the item. You post it to us at our expense. We check it for quality. We pay you, and then we list it for sale.
Yeah.
Now, that's been a mad learning curve, because I'm like, this is easy. We can do this. Or these technical guys that know how to do this can do this. Not easy at all. It's cost a lot more money than we thought. It's taken a lot more time than we thought, and it's still not completely finished. It's not perfect for us. So we've got one website where you can scan in up to 45 million different barcodes and it will identify the item. That
Wow.
is incredible. On top of that, so we've got to identify the right item. Then we've got to come up with a value for the item. That
Right.
became so complicated, we made a separate website just to do the valuation. And that's not even working properly yet because it's just so difficult.
Wow.
On top of that, with that second website, values. So that's a tool for us for this first website, but we're all going to sell it, also going to sell it on a subscription basis to our competitors so they can use it as well. So they can go into a thrift shop, scan a barcode on their phone on the app, and it can tell them basically red light or green light, buy it or don't buy it based on some information they put in. So that's a good example of us helping ourselves, but also helping other people at the same time. Because that's a tool we don't have here. We don't have Scout IQ or
Right.
Scoutly or any of
Right.
these tools you guys are used to in America.
Right.
So with the technology, the infusion we're doing at the minute is, okay, we've got these old-fashioned SKU systems. We've also got another website that's, I've been saying for 5 weeks, is almost ready, because it is almost ready. We've tested it. The guys that are building have tested it. What that does is you scan a barcode, it automatically does a title, it automatically fills in item specifics, it puts up a stock image, it automatically comes up with a price point based on some parameters we put in. And it means it takes potentially a 2 minute job down to a 2 second job. So this is how, when we're talking about we're going to list 10,000 items a day, and then we're going to go into a regular pattern of every single day to 1,000 listings. We're not joking, because it's only going to take us 2 hours. How quickly can you scan 10,000 CDs and put them in a box and have someone else putting them away? So that's how we're connecting old-fashioned systems with new systems. So
Where do all these ideas come from? Because nobody like this. Where do these ideas come from? And like, what do you? Because I know you probably have 10 million ideas. What do you decide to take action on? What do you not? Because we've already talked about a huge eBay business. We've talked about becoming a distributor for disc cleaning machines. You're building websites that buy back. You're acquiring stock through the website. Now you're, letting other people have access to the website. You're going to have a scanner that does 10,000 listings a day. Where does it stop, Tom?
I'm very frustrated and I'm very unhappy. And I'm very unhappy with eBay. I have a love-hate relationship. I love eBay. Oh, believe me, I love eBay, but I also hate them with a passion. All right. And it's a weird conundrum. And it's like, in my mind, things that should have been implemented on eBay 10 years ago haven't been implemented.
Oh, for sure.
They're not innovating anymore. They're replicating. So Amazon came to Australia and eBay got worried about that. and they started trying to compete with Amazon. Instead of competing with Amazon, they should have just stuck with what they're good at, which is a lot of weird, quirky items that you can't find anywhere else, collectibles, secondhand, as well as new. I'm not saying ignore the new market, but don't favor the new market over the secondhand market.
And you know what's interesting, Tom? They did the same thing 10 years ago here and almost ruined the platform. It's mind-blowing that they repeated the same mistake in Australia recently.
So this is what frustrates me, and they don't listen to us. And I mean, you've been on eBay a long time. You've done huge numbers, and I remember you saying basically you've never had anything from them. They haven't sent you a hat, a bumper sticker. Like, we're not talking about much. We're talking about a little bit of recognition and maybe them reaching out to you and saying, what could we do for you to help improve you selling more on our platform and
Right.
making
The
us more money?
people that are on the platform the most, what do you see? Where are we lacking? Where are there holes in the market, like you said? How can we improve? The people that are actually using the platform the most day in and day out. I 1,000% agree with you.
So what I'm doing is I'm quite a vindictive person. When I feel like someone's wronged me, I'm like, I'll stew on this for 15 years and I'll somehow get my revenge. And my revenge, normally it's positive. Like, I'm not out to kill anyone, but I'm out to, like, I might want to kill their business, you know, or I might want to be, all right, well, this person ripped us off $10,000 10 years ago and they
Oh,
sell
it's not over.
CDs.
It's not over.
Oh, no,
No.
that'll stay with me forever. So it's like
Same
with
thing.
eBay, we've reached out multiple times. You get nothing from them. Okay, cool. We understand how it works. What I'm interested in doing is saying we can build a better website than what eBay is in Australia, but we can't get the traffic to it. But as far as radical plans go, one of the big plans is build a website that is by resellers for resellers. Ignore the mass-produced, brand new Chinese market, you know, all the stuff coming in from China. We're not really interested in that. We're interested in the good sellers that sell good items that are difficult to find, that have got a better profit margin than 10 cents on a mass-produced item. All right? Niche market. So they did it in America with the reverb business.
Reverb, yep.
So, you know, musical instruments were sold on eBay. These guys saw a hole in the market. They've made a better platform to sell musical instruments and that sort of stuff. And I think they dominate that market now. And I'm like, that's fantastic. So what I want to do here in Australia is have this website that's set up that is an even playing field for buyers and sellers, where a buyer and a seller can leave each other negative feedback. And if they want that removed, they've got to work together to sort it out themselves. And on one occasion, they can remove that feedback, exactly like what they do on the Discogs website for selling CDs and records. So straight off the bat, you reduce the overhead for customer service. So a lot of the
Sure.
time we contact eBay, it's about getting your feedback removed where someone's got the wrong end of the stick. You know, if we haven't done the wrong thing, and they're wasting a lot of their time and money on doing that.
Absolutely.
So it's
Absolutely.
like, take that out of the equation, you save a lot of money and you make a better, fairer platform where it's not favored in such a direction just for the buyer. You know, it's more even. And I like that idea. It's a simple concept. So that's one thing. The other thing is, you know, if you want to do certain things on eBay, like printing the label, they want you to pay on the platform to print the label because they get more money that way. So they
Sure.
won't let you do certain things with labels unless you pay for the postage on the platform. That goes against the customer service for the seller, and it makes it difficult, and it means the more time I've got to waste dealing with that sort of stuff, the less time I've got to sell stuff on the platform. So you want to even it out and make it a better selling experience. So big platform, get a bunch of niche market sellers on there, and it's not open so not anyone can sign up. We headhunt sellers. We'll go, okay, you got 50 different niche categories. You got this clothing seller. They're doing a really good job. Their feedback's good on eBay. Customer service is good. Everything's good. They're a professional seller. We'll invite these guys. On top of that, instead of getting them to pay to use the platform, we'll pay them to do listings, right? So what you do is you say, all right, for every item you list, we might pay you 50 cents, you know? So it's only a small amount. And when you sell that item, we'll deduct 50 cents
Recapture
from
it.
exactly. Now, I don't know how to set that up so it's essentially foolproof, so we can't get ripped off where you get someone that's got a bunch of VAs and they suddenly list a million items.
Right.
So that's why you've got to headhunt your sellers. But if you get quality sellers in niche markets and you get a whole collection of them and you build up this nice little collection of really good sellers, they'll bring their own people in because it's a niche market. They'll have their own Facebook group and they'll be able to bring people in. It's starting off small with a nice solid platform and building it up. I don't want to go and compete with eBay flat out. I want to have a similar website that does compete with them, but not on that whole platform scale. You know, I'm not going to go, okay, eBay does this, we must compete with that. You know, or Amazon does this, we must compete with that. We want to build our own platform, buy sellers for sellers, and go from there. So that's one of the bigger plans. And that's, you know, we're talking just the developments over $1 million,
Sure.
the time to do it. You know, that's, it's not just you build it and they'll come. It's like you build it, you maintain it, you expand it, you're always working on it. You've got to have a full-time team of people working on that stuff.
Sure.
So that's a big plan. But what we're doing now to start it off is we're building tools that we can plug into the website. So one tool we're building is what we call the listed tool, lit. And that's the thing where you scan the barcode, 2 seconds later, it's all done. So we'll build that. We'll use it. And then we'll build something else to help us list more on eBay. And then we might build five of these different tools that are individual tools in themselves, but then we'll plug them all in together as pieces of the puzzle. And then that's when we have this giant website. So on eBay now, there's a whole bunch of third-party operators that give you some added benefit or help you do something on eBay. eBay should be implementing that stuff already.
Yeah.
Like eBay's got Afterpay. Why doesn't eBay offer their own version of Afterpay? You know, like in this day and age, I shouldn't have buyers that don't pay for items because as soon as they buy it, they should be able to, the order should be processed and paid for by eBay. Then that buyer pays eBay and they should sort out that end of it. I don't know why they don't do things like that. To me, that's simple and it solves problems and it makes more money for them.
Do you think that because the only argument I have ever offered or ever thought of why they don't have immediate payment on everything is just because that's the culture of eBay. The culture of eBay is you can win an item and you have 7 days to pay. So that's like the only reason why I can think about why they don't have immediate payment for everything.
They're a very old-fashioned platform. The platform itself is very clunky. And it's like, look, they've done well because it's so old and it's been a good business. But this lack of innovation, it's costing them money. And I always said to Mel, if you wanted to do a real heavy-hitting video, you'd do a video about how eBay was a bad investment for investors buying shares in eBay because they're not innovating anymore. And you're better off looking at a small startup and investing in that instead. But you don't make any friends at eBay doing that sort of thing.
No, and if you take a look at the categories that they've innovated the most, it's categories that they got their tail kicked. Shoes, they got their tails kicked by StockX. Musical instruments, they got their tails kicked by Refurb. Watches, they got their tails kicked by Chrono 45 or whatever the website is. Every single category where they start getting their tails kicked, they will innovate in those categories or offer authentication or whatever it may be, but why does it take them losing a portion of the market share for them to innovate rather than being forward thinking and never even letting these small websites even in the picture? That's the part that I don't understand.
They're not good at taking preemptive strikes, and they're
No.
not good at they're not good at seeing the big picture.
They
They're good at
always
seeing the
react
end.
to everything. Like offers to watchers was a Poshmark idea that they stole and reacted. That should have offers to watchers made me $100,000 the year they put it out.
Oh yeah.
What are we doing?
I know they've got some smart people in the organization, but I know they've got a bunch of people that lack imagination and lack the guts to do something. The problem with eBay in Australia is any decision they make, if it's a big decision, has to go through America. Now, straight
And the
away,
shareholders.
well, straight away, it's going to take 6 months. It's going to
Sure.
cost them an arm and a leg. It's
Sure.
like, you either trust these guys to do the job or you don't. So in the UK, the British eBay is separate to the Americans. They don't have to get permission from head office, so to speak. You know,
Oh,
they
is
can
that
make some,
so?
yeah, apparently. Apparently. So they can make some decisions or big decisions by themselves. So we're already in Australia, we're a bit hamstrung by that. And it's, to me, it's old fashioned and it's foolish.
Yeah, if that's the scenario, nothing in Australia is getting done.
Not quickly anyway.
Right.
They do test a lot of things out here. So we notice new features come out here before they come out in America. It's like they use us as a testing
It's
ground,
more
which can
controlled.
go. That can go either way. But I mean, I look at it and I see there's a hole in the market. There's a hole in the market for a good competitor, so to speak, website to fill a bunch of these holes. Little things like we get a lot of item not received cases for low dollar items that there's no tracking on. We offer tracking to people if they pay small amount extra for it. They never do. And then they claim the item hasn't arrived on the day it did arrive. And normally you can pick it. Like we had one a little while ago. You did an item not received case. And I bluffed him and I said, oh, look, we've spoken to Australia Post. According to this, it has been delivered on this time at this date. And he doesn't know. He doesn't know we're bluffing. And so he closes the case. Oh, yeah, my neighbor had it. And then a week later, the same seller, we blocked him. But a week later, he bought something else off us. And a week later, he does the same thing. And I called him out straight away on it. And then I went to the next level and I actually contacted a bunch of other sellers I know that have sold him CDs and said, did this guy do this to you as well? And they all confirmed, yeah, he did. I'm like, how many times can someone do this on eBay before eBay take action? And I'm thinking, all right, a simple solution to that is this. If you pay for tracking and your item doesn't arrive, you're covered. If you don't pay for tracking, you, the buyer, are not covered. And then that opens up people like me are able to sell items cheaper because we don't have to build that potential fraud into our selling costs. So we can sell more items for cheaper. The buyer gets a better experience. We get a better experience and the platform gets more money. But they won't do things like that. And it just boggles my mind.
So why do you think they don't do things like that? Can that be too easily gamed by sellers where every single time someone does it without tracking, they just don't send? They would have to have a metric where like they audit the seller to make sure that they're fulfilling their obligation, or have, trusted sellers, just like how Amazon in America, they have FBA, but it's really FBM. It's FBA, but I'm going to send it out to my house. So that person has been vetted as a trustworthy person. They're going to send it out when they say they are, in the condition, at the speed. And that right there can solve a problem that you guys have in Australia.
The way they need to do it is they need to look at their sellers and go, right, you're worthy of partnering with us. We trust you to do the right thing.
Right.
And it needs to be a two-way street. You do need to vet your people and you need to look at who's got a proven track record. It is in my best interest to do the right thing by my customer and the right thing by the platform, and
That's
it
right.
benefits everybody,
That's right.
right? Those are the people you target. You don't target everyone. You don't target the
Sure.
dodgy seller. You know,
Sure.
and there are
Like
dodgy sellers out there.
this guy over here has shipped 10,000 items, never a late shipment. That's a good candidate for us.
Yeah, exactly. So there's got to
Yeah.
be a metric they would look at. But I mean, are these guys even talking about this? Or are they talking about, oh, this person said something bad about us on a podcast in America. Now we're going to go and target them. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know what goes on at head office, but I'm like, I see some smart decisions, but few and far between. I see a lot of this is bogging us down. This is delaying us from selling more on your platform. So every time we've got a credit card chargeback or a negative feedback that we don't believe we deserve, the amount of time we've got to spend talking to customer service at eBay, it costs them money, costs us money and energy. And it's energy we could put into selling more on their platform. So I'm passionate about helping people, helping myself, helping my guys. And I figure one way of doing that is how can we solve this problem? You know, is it too much of a crazy idea to say, let's build a big website that does this. And it's not, it's just a case of you need to have the thought process, you need to have that goal and be driven. You've got to have those finances behind you, and you've got to headhunt the right people to help you. The guys I've got helping me now build some of this software are exceptionally good at what they do. You know, we go to them with some complex problems and go, right, this is the problem we've got. We need to identify 45 million different barcodes. And they're like, all right, give us a bit of time to think about that and try a few things. And they come back with a solution, go, all right, this is what the solution is. This is how much it's going to cost. This is what we've got to do. This is the timeline. Okay, cool. Let's do it. You know, it's like when that software first came about with the listing tool, they said, all right, it's going to be about $16,000. And in my head, I'm like, is that worth it or not? And I spoke to a few people in the group about it, and everyone's like, yeah, that's a no-brainer. You got to go for that straight away. I mean, the price has ballooned since then because it's been a lot harder and more complex than we expected. So it's going to cost more. But at the same time, I mean, the difference that's going to make to our business, because it means we can do our pick and pack in the morning, and that might take us a couple of hours, you know, unless it's a really busy Monday where we have to spend half the day. And then we can go and do 1,000 listings in 2 hours from start to finish. And then we can use the rest of the day for doing more intelligent stuff, sourcing, setting up a new system, doing things like making a bulk lot. You know, there's all this more intelligent stuff that we can do based on our experience and our knowledge, and not something that we can get a computer or robot to do for us. So that's what I'm looking at. And the other thing is, I sort of look at where we were 10 years ago, where we're going to, and I'm trying to almost predict the future and go, okay, is eBay a sinking ship? Is it just going to get harder and harder and more expensive? It's going to cost us more to sell. Our margins are going to go down. We're going to have to sell stuff cheaper because we've got more competitors. What's it going to look like in 5 years? So I'm like, all right, how can we diversify our income streams? What can we do to safeguard ourselves for the future? What can we do to predict what could happen? And you sort of play the what if game and go, okay, what if we get kicked off eBay tomorrow? What's the backup plan? All right. We've got a backup plan. It's not ideal. It is what it is. But you sort of look at all this stuff and you try and troubleshoot. And it's, I think if you're an entrepreneur and you've got your own business, if you're not good at solving problems, you've got no business being an entrepreneur. Because to me, it's about solving problems for other people and yourself. So that's the way my mind works.
Obviously, you put a lot of thought into everything. And if you or if you thought eBay was a sinking ship, why the desire to develop a software that can list 10,000 listings in a day?
I think we've got to give it a really. I said to myself a long time ago, if we're going to do this, we're going to do it. You know, we're going to go there hard, and we're going to hit it as hard as we can. But we're restricted. So we get in touch with eBay and we go, we need access to API for this and this. And if you give us API access, this will benefit our sales by X amount on your platform. And you go to them and you say, if you let us have this access, we'll be able to do an extra $2 million in sales. And they still don't give it to you. So I'm like, all right, well, there will always be a market for people wanting to buy things and people wanting to sell things. So eBay, in my opinion, may be a sinking ship and might be a very slow sinking ship, or it may just be this is about as good as it's going to get, and it's probably not going to get much better until a real significant competitor comes on the scene and really jostles them. And then they do a knee-jerk reaction and they suddenly freak out and do, oh, let's do a store-wide, a site-wide 20% off, and we'll cover the cost. You know, eBay's done that before for their some of their birthdays. Now sales have gone ballistic. So I think their platform, in my opinion, might be a bit of a slow sinking ship, but that doesn't mean all e-commerce on the website, online, on the internet is. So I think there's always room there for a competitor. It's like Instagram, before they made Instagram, tried to buy Flickr, and Flickr wouldn't sell to Instagram. They said, we're the top dog. We don't want to sell it, blah, blah, blah. So Instagram went off and competed with them and overtook them. No one even knows who Flickr is, what Flickr was anymore. But everyone knows what Instagram is.
Right.
And it's like, it can be done. Those guys, obviously, huge amount of experience, huge budget. We don't have that. But I'm smart enough to go out and headhunt people that I think can do the job and work out the budget and work out if we can achieve it or not. And that's what we're working towards. But it's very slow steps. It might take us 5 years, 10 years to do it. Who knows? And by that time, the whole playing field might have changed.
So, competition is healthy for any marketplace. Like you said, if a competitor came to eBay, eBay would tighten up. Instagram competed with Flickr. They made the wrong decision. So as someone that is, at the top of the niche in the country, how do competitors make you better? How do you view the competition to make yourself better?
We buy a lot on eBay. And we see what a lot of our competitors are doing, because we'll buy a CD to, like, we might be missing volume 2 out of a volume 1 to 10 pack. And so we go on eBay to buy that. And we see the quality product people are sending out, the way it's packaged and everything. And I'm not saying we're the best, but we're better than a lot of these other guys. We've got better systems, better packaging, better labels. It's a quicker, easier process. It's not these handwritten fake tracking numbers on things and stuff like that. At the same time, we've got some competitors that are on point, and some of our competitors are much better than what we are, but we're just much bigger than what they are. And we can learn a lot off them as well. One of the best relationships I've got with someone on eBay is one of our biggest competitors, and I suspect they're the number one CD seller at the minute. So, looking forward to knocking them off the post, so to speak. But Their product and their price points is really good, and they're cheaper than we are. We're making more money because we're charging more, but their service is just as good as ours is. They had an issue where they wanted to do international, and they got in touch with us and they said, who do you guys use for international? And it's no skin off our nose to help them. So we've helped them, and we told them exactly who we use, how we do it. Here's a contact point person to talk to this guy, mention me, happy days. That works really well. In turn, 6 months later, we bought something from this competitor and had a label on it. We're like, man, this label is really good. I wonder how they did that. So I get in touch with them. How'd you do this label? We got an IT guy in here, and he spoke to our IT guy for 30 minutes on the phone explaining exactly how to do it. Then we had to set up a system to do it. So this is our competitor helping us, and we're helping them. But it's for everyone's benefit. And since then, we've had a really good relationship where at one point he wanted to sell his business to us. I talked him out of it. I said, look, the money we'll pay you for your business is not what it's worth. It's worth a lot more. But it's worth a lot more because you're there and the system you've built. Don't sell it. I know it's hard sometimes, but you've got to deal with it, man. Like it's and gave them some strategies and basically pep talked them into keeping the business. And they're like, oh, look, we're still on the fence. And I said, all right, well, I want 3 price points. I want the price for the business, walk in, walk out. The business, walk in, walk out, and you stay on as a full-time employee. Because his problem was, I don't want to work 70 hours a week. I only want to work 40. Yeah. So I'm like, all right, we'll pay you to work 40 hours a week, full-time wage. And then I said, then we want a price for just the stock. But then I also said in the same email, I think you're making a mistake. You shouldn't sell it to me. And I think he respected that, and he stuck with the business. And it's good because he buys CD cleaning machines off us and supplies. So it's really nice to have this really good working relationship with one of our main competitors. And at the same time, we don't go out of our way to undercut him and step on his toes. And I don't think we really would, because he sells a lot more at a much lower price. And we're more like a bit more long tail style. We're more interested in it might take longer to sell, but it sells at a higher price. But we do adjust that from time to time, depending on how many staff we've got, what's going on in our business. And we do realize, like, media sellers, it's a numbers game. You've got to sell more for a lower price so you can sell more and keep it going. And that's really how you make money. You don't make money by selling $10 item a day. You make money by selling the 10 $1 items every day and then keep going from there. So it's good. And I think it's very beneficial to keep a close eye on your competitors. And I think one of the best ways you can do that is buy off them. See what they send out and see how they send it out and check them out.
So if the money wasn't the deterrent for the deal, let's say the money was right, why didn't you just buy the business?
I think I'm not in this to get rich quick overnight, you know. I'm in this because I'm trying to build an empire. I'm trying to build something very, very big, something much bigger than what I am. And it doesn't really, I mean, it's a cash grab. Like if I go and buy all this stock and just sell it like for a really low price and then sell it for a higher price and I'll make a lot of money, that's great, you know, for that
One and
small.
done, right? Not repeatable.
Exactly. So to me, I'm better off. This guy's a serious operator. Like he's got good systems as well. In my opinion, they're not as good as ours, but you know, I'm biased. But it's good to have good professional competitors because it keeps you on your toes as well. Like if you're at the top of your game and no one comes close, it's kind of boring. Like I'm a competitive person. That's why I like stirring up Mel, my girlfriend, all the time about when the number three book sell and she's number four. She hates it. She gets brittle, man. She's like, I'm gonna destroy the CD market for you. I'm gonna do videos on YouTube about how to sell CDs. And I'm like, that's cool, man. I'll start a YouTube channel. It'll be called, you know, What's Cooking with Tom. We'll talk about selling books all day, you know. No worries, bring it on. But I like that rivalry. As long as it's positive,
Yeah,
it brings each other up. It
I
can
agree.
get negative, but you've got to keep it real, you know.
So one of the questions that I have on here as you were talking is that you are high priced in the market versus being a little bit lower and selling more like the competitor. Why?
I think we offer a good professional service, and I don't like the idea of myself or my guys working for nothing. If we're not working for a financial reward or working for some sort of pride in what we do, it's not so good. So I get a lot of energy off myself and my guys having high morale. And we get motivated a lot by results. We're results driven. You know, we like to come in and feel like we've done a good day's work and we've achieved something, you know, because none of us are rich from this at this point, you know. It's all the money that comes into the business is going out on bills, paying my guys, paying the warehouse, rent and all that sort of stuff and all the overheads. But we're just scaling it up. You know, we're just constantly scaling it up. A lot of our competitors sell stuff, they do volume at low margins, and some of them are really good operators and everything's on point, and some aren't. And some of these guys operate from their house, they don't have the overheads we do. So automatically, we've got to generally charge a bit more. If we get stuff at a lower price, we can sell it at a lower price. But if it costs us more money to get it in, then we've got to sell it obviously at the higher price. But I think when we get our systems to the point where all our listings can be done in 2 seconds and we can sort of scale it up, we will focus more on the lower priced items. But at the same time, it's the future of reselling, it changes and you've got to roll with the punches and roll with patterns and change up what you do. And it's like, all right, well, we're selling the CD DVD cleaning machines. We're buying in as much stock as we can, and straight off the bat, we're taking off that top 10% sought after items because of supply demand. And we're selling those high-end items. The same amount of work and the same expense that goes into selling an item for $50 is the same amount of work and the same amount of effort that goes into selling the $5 item. The price points are very different. So I said to my guys a little while ago, we might change up for a little bit. What we'll do is we'll buy as much as we can. Take out that top 10%, sought after stuff, the stuff we want, the niche market, the crazy heavy metal stuff, or the stuff you just can't find anywhere. Sell that for a premium price, based on the supply and demand of the market. And then what we'll do with the less desirable stuff, the stuff we've already got 50 copies of that just doesn't sell, we'll put that into bulk lots. We'll sell that to competitors that are happy with the lower margin. They just want decent titles at a low price, and they'll just sell it in volume. They can do the heavy lifting, hopefully sell them a CD DVD cleaning machine at the same time. And then what we do is we become a supplier to sellers. So one of the holes in the market here in Australia is there is no business that caters to resellers. So I need to go get stock from somewhere. As a CD seller, I need CDs. I also need a CD DVD cleaning machine and the supplies for it. And I also need bubble mailers to post them out. Why is there not one stop shop that does all that? So that's one thing we're like, we can sell replenishables in the CD DVD cleaning machines and the supplies. We can sell the high-end, top-end stuff that we're more excited about listing. We're more passionate about listing that more expensive, more valuable stuff. And then for the lower dollar stuff, we'll sell a bit of it, but then we're better off just doing it in a bulk listing and selling it to a competitor. So that's something we're going to be trying in a little while. We've sold bulk lots to competitors before. The problem is in the postage cost because Australia is such a vast country. A lot of the time, the person you want to sell the stuff to, they're not next door. Like they're a 2 day drive away in the middle of nowhere. So it's very expensive to send those bigger lots out. So that's what we're sort of looking at going forward. And again, it comes down to what is the future of reselling? What does this model look like in a year's time? That's what we're trying to look at and go, right, are we better off sticking with this model or this, or doing a little bit of this model and a bit of that? It gets quite complicated, but you just got to look at it and go, right, where are the holes in the market? Where can we plug those holes? What's good for us? What's good for our buyers? And sort of go from there,
All right, so the future of eBay, I spent a lot of time, future of reselling, future of the market, I spent a lot of time thinking about that. So you are kind of outlining two methods. One is a little bit higher average sale price, a little more sought after items. And then one is obviously that hyper bulk model of media. If you had to make a decision today, what's the future?
The first, the individual listings of items, because I don't just get fulfilled in the business from seeing money go into the bank account, but it's also when you get an email from someone that goes, I've been looking for this forever and I've finally found it and it's in great condition. Thank you very much. Or my autistic daughter, this is her favorite Wiggles movie. She broke it. We're desperate to get it. Is it in good condition? Can you get it to us quickly? She's having endless tantrums. I'm desperate to get this. At the end of the day, you've got to look back at your life when you're on your deathbed and go, am I happy? Was I fulfilled with what I did, or was I not? I'm not in this just to make money. And that is what makes me quite dangerous to a lot of my competitors, because they're in it just to make a quick buck. Whereas we're pretty resilient and we're trying to build an empire and do something that helps a whole bunch of people. So we're trying to build something much bigger than just ourselves. So I think sticking with the individual items, that's much more fulfilling for us, even if they're low dollar ones. It's much more fulfilling. If all we did all day was just sell bulk, I wouldn't get that same fulfillment. It's like if you start off your eBay business as a hobbyist and then you go from that to doing it full time, you very quickly lose a bit of enjoyment because you come to the realization, this isn't just a bit of fun on the weekend. This is my bread and butter now. This is my full-time job. And it's not like you go from doing it a few hours on the weekend to 40 hours a week. It's like 100 hours a week. Like I don't not work. Like I'm always working or thinking about it or doing something that's work related. It's not a good
Absolutely.
work-life balance,
No,
but I
I
enjoy it.
100%. All right, so that's the road there, and I think though the future of the market, me personally, is more of that small margin bulk model. I just think it's just going to be death by a thousand cuts. We just get hammered from every single direction. The expenses are just going to keep rising, and we have to do more work for the same amount of money. I think to have the kind of like that specialist store, I don't know if you could do that specialist store to the scale that you want to do, because you want to do huge store. How do you do this huge operation without that, for lack of a better term, like the penny book, the penny? How do you do it? Because in order to get those awesome items, you got to go through a lot of garbage.
Sarah from the Aussie part of the group, said a while ago when I was talking about this software we're doing. She goes, "Where's that leave mom and pop sellers?" And I go, "They'll be fine, but they can't keep doing the way they can't keep doing business in Australia the way they have been, you know, because we'll get to a point where people won't be able to compete with us selling CDs because we'll have such low prices, such a good product, all our systems ticked off.
Sure.
But the good thing about this market is they can compete with us, but it's based on the supply demand. They can go and find a rare item that we don't have, and they can sell it for premium money. That is a better option. You're better off, in my opinion, selling less items for a much higher price than selling heaps of really cheap items. The more
Sure.
cheap items you sell, the more problems you have. All your expenses go up, and I don't think you're in a better position. You know, unless you get to that point where you're selling 100,000 items a day, and then, you know, 1,000 people say that item didn't arrive, and you just automatically refund them and just block them and move on. We're very passionate about that. We're very passionate against people that defraud us. And if we know someone's scamming us, we do things to try and prevent them from doing that to more sellers. Again, I think that's one area where eBay, I mean, look, eBay's got a hard job because they're trying to balance between buyers and sellers.
Yeah, and
And
they
in
don't
dip
know if it arrived, didn't arrive. So yeah, you're right. I don't know if there's a perfect solution to that point, but I just don't know, especially in the media category, how you find that balance between humongous large store penny CD, where you said something that was very interesting. The more items you sell, the more problems you have, which is absolutely true because you need infrastructure, you need people, you need customer service. It's a whole bunch of stuff where, of course, if we can all sell one yacht a year and make $100,000, we would just do that. So, like, we all have to find that balance inside of that. But more often than not, in the media category, it skews towards bulk, especially when you get into 132,000 items. So how do you navigate that? How do you balance that part of it? Because like point Tom in the direction of 132,000 spectacular high price items.
Look, it can be done, but it's difficult and it's a huge investment. And it just goes, all right, when we started, we're playing with a $200 kitty, and then we're playing with a $2,000 kitty as far as going out and buying stock goes. So it's like, all right, well, do we learn the market and do we headhunt items and snipe items and buy items off eBay and then value add to them and then sell them for a higher price? And one of the areas where a lot of resellers let themselves down is they have the mindset, they've got the experience and the knowledge, but they still bog down with doing the nitty-gritty stuff that they shouldn't be doing. Like I'm still taking the rubbish bins out of the warehouse and emptying them into the hopper. I'm vacuuming the warehouse. I'm doing all this stuff that by rights I shouldn't be doing because I should have my guys doing that, and I should be focusing on stuff that I've got the mindset and the experience for. So Mel's a good example. I'm like, all right, you've got the mindset, you know what to buy, all right? You don't need to be taking all the photos, and you don't necessarily need to be doing all the listings and doing all the dispatch. You could get a staff member in, train them up how to do that. Then you can focus on what you're good at, which is going out and sourcing the items. And what I'm talking about is going out to numerous shops and sales and whatnot, instead of buying bulk, being selective and going, all right, that'll give me a $40 profit margin. I'll buy that, you know, and then I'll get my person to deal with it. To me, it's like you've got to recognize your strengths and your weaknesses. And in my opinion, outsource your weaknesses to someone that's an expert. So I don't do my own accounting. I pay someone else to do that because I'm not an expert at that. And then I focus on the stuff that I know how to do in the business that the other guys don't. So buying certain items to then resell because I know the other sellers. And I've got the experience what to look for and what not to look for. And I think this is a trap a lot of people fall into. If you want to scale, if you don't want to scale, it's fine. Just do everything yourself. But if you want to scale, you've got to get people around you because you can't do everything yourself. And you're not Superman, you know. You've got to, if you are good at one thing, do that, focus on that. And if you're bad at something else, get someone else to do it that's good at it, you know. And I think that's something. A lot of resellers aren't willing to let go. They're not willing to pass their baby to someone else, and they're worried. They want that control. But you gotta, if you want to scale, you gotta get out of that quickly, you know, that mindset.
100%. So when the book fair calls, it's the last day, they have 30 Gaylords of books. They can't all be fantastic books. Why do you do that type of deal? What are you looking for when that phone rings and they say, "Hey, we got 30 Gaylords of books. Come pick them up, Tom."
It's a bit more in depth than that. It's not, we don't get phone calls like that. We've got to reach out to people and we've got to set these deals up maybe 3 months in advance. And it's we've got to have the logistics equipment there. We've got to have people there. We've got to have a truck there. We've got to organize a whole bunch of stuff. And sometimes it can be done very quickly. We can do it in a couple of days. And then we need space back at the warehouse to unload everything and whatnot. So certain book fairs we'll deal with, certain ones we won't. So there's one of the biggest ones we go to used to be really good. But what happened was they opened a retail shop and they realized we do the book fair on the last day. We do what's known as a bag sale, as much as you can fit this bag for this price. And then what they're doing is because they know that book fair, that bag sale's coming, a lot of the really expensive items they're pulling out of there before that. And they're going and putting those in their retail shop. And then at the end of the sale, they're going around, they're picking out all the stuff again that they think they can sell in their retail shop. And then everything else, they say they're recycling it, but they're not. It's getting loaded into a dumpster and it's going to the rubbish tip. And the main reason for that is it's difficult to recycle a lot of books that have got glossy covers or they've got glue in the spine. It can't be recycled easily. And so they say to everyone they're recycling it, but they're not. It's going to the tip. It's pretty upsetting. And it's all these volunteers for these organizations have done all this work to do quality control and to price the item, and then it's ending up in landfill. And I'm quite passionate about having an environmental solution to that. I'm not a greenie, but I know the difference between the right thing to do and the wrong thing to do. And to me, it's like, if we buy all those books, and even if only 10% of them are good for our purposes, to sell on eBay, justifying the postage is quite expensive for the book because they're big and heavy. Then we can do that. And with the leftovers, what we can do is we can either then send them to an auction house and just auction them off to someone else, or we can donate them to another book fair in a smaller area that might be crying out for books. And that's what we're doing at the minute. So we buy all these books in. We do a sort, we pull out what we think will be good, we try and lot stuff together. The rest of it, we go, all right, we don't think this will sell for these reasons. There's 10 copies of it available on eBay. They're already basically at cost price and they're not selling. So why would we then list it? We don't want to add to the problem, we want to add to the solution. So instead of dealing with that book, we put in another Gaylord and we send it to this other charity and go, here you go, guys. And then what they do is they sell them off. And any that they don't sell off, I think they do actually have an arrangement to recycle some of them, but I think it's quite labor intensive. They've got to remove spines off books and stuff like that. So to me, it's like you've helped be part of the solution. Now, with that book fair, that particular one I'm talking about, because they're pulling all this stuff out, instead of it getting that sort of 10% of really good stuff and then 90% less desirable. It's mainly all that less desirable. So we don't deal with those guys anymore. But what we do deal is we deal with one of their essentially competitors, and they don't do that. You know, everything at the end of it is still there. You know, they're not cherry picking stuff out. So it justifies it for us. We're getting it at such a low price. The price to transport it and to do the logistics is higher than the price we pay for the items. So to us, it's a huge amount of work. It is quite a burden. But it's a good thing to do. So that's what we're doing at the minute. I think what I'm interested in is buying as much as possible, cherry picking, and then having good, quick, cost-effective means to distribute the leftovers, whether we sell them or donate them, whatever we do. But we don't want to fall into the trap where we store them. We don't want to hang on to them. We want it quick in, quick out. And that's what we're working on. We're working on our processes being that good. So it's like we're crying out for stock because we have nothing to work on and we're twiddling our thumbs. We're picking and packing a lot, but then we have no stock to play with. So we need to try and get more in. And I'm thinking, you always need to feed the beast. If you ever stop buying in this business, unless you're struggling to do five listings a day and you're operating out of your house and you're by yourself, if you're trying to scale and you've got teams and you've got space and the means to do so, you should always be buying as much as you can because it's hard to buy and it's hard to find that good, that top 10%.
So that was the answer that I was looking for, because you were saying that, you want the better quality items, but media is such a bulk operation. I know you do these huge deals, so I'm wondering, like, how do we get to these better items? And you've answered it by you're getting these items in, you're culling the top 10%, and then you're finding a home for the other one. So that makes perfect sense, because from the outside looking in, you bought 30 Gaylords, and I'm like, is this guy listing all of this stuff on eBay? So that philosophy does make perfect sense, but it's a massive undertaking bringing in 30 Gaylords. What is it, 500, 1,000 books per Gaylord? How are you guys processing this in a timely enough manner where it can still be profitable between this is an acceptable eBay book, this one has 20 copies, this one is not worth it? Do is the expertise there? I mean, I know Mel has an immense expertise. Can she literally go through the Gaylords and say this one is good, this one is not good? Do you have people that can literally look at them? Do you have scanners? How are you doing it in such a timely fashion where it doesn't bog you down?
At the minute, it does bog us down. Two of the goals for this year is to get on top of all our unlisted inventory and to increase our listings to 250,000. As soon as we get that software working correctly, that won't be a problem. That will be quite a quick and easy process for us to do.
Well,
So
the
at the minute,
listing portion will be quick and easy. Figuring out what is good and not good, that's a monumental task.
yeah, it is. So at the minute, what I'm doing is this. Mel is great and she's got good expertise, but
Yes.
the problem is she's busy with her own stuff and we can't occupy all her time.
That's right.
I'm conscious of that. I'd love to occupy all her time. I'd love to have Mel working for me full time. It'll never
Sure.
happen. You
Sure.
know, I couldn't afford her for starters. So at the minute, what we're doing is I'm sorting the books. Basically, this has got a barcode. This doesn't have a barcode. And as I'm doing that, I'm also going, okay, that's an interesting book. I'll put that aside. This is definitely a no. So it might be a good book, but it might be way too big, too hard to store, too hard to post, too expensive. So it's like, we'll donate that one. These guys will be happy with that. But there are certain books. The book might be in a foreign language. It might be badly damaged. It could be moldy. There could be issues with it. And that will just either generally discard because we don't have the means to recycle. We'd love to recycle, but we don't have the means to. Not in a cost-effective way anyway. So basically what I'm doing is a yes, no. I'm saying, all right, these are barcodes, these are not barcodes, these are good ones. The good ones I'll prioritize and I'll go and list those basically straight away. And I might do 1,000 books and then I'll spend the rest of the day listing. With the barcode, no barcode, the rationale behind that is with the barcoded books, they're quicker and easier to deal with. You know, I don't have to type stuff. I can just scan a barcode. And so what I do is I get them in front of me, a stack of 30 at a time. I'll scan a barcode. I'll see everyone selling it at $15, but it's going to cost us $12 to post it. It's not worth it. So we'll put that aside. And basically that then gets donated. Or we're looking at doing a massive sale where every book's a dollar. And anyone can come into this specific portion of the warehouse, and for one day only, anything in there is dollar each. We haven't done that before, and we're thinking about doing that now because we want stuff going to good homes, and we want quick in, quick out. We don't want to store stuff. We're not in the storage business. So, with the barcoded books, they're quick and easy to deal with. With the non-barcoded books, it's more time consuming. You've got to type stuff. There's also a lot more value in a lot of those books. Because a lot of people don't want to deal with them because they can't just scan the barcode. And that's the way we're dealing with the books at the minute. But it is a slow process. And I've given myself, as I said before, the start of this year, I gave myself until the end of the year to get on top of all of this. Because we want to deal with a lot of stuff, but we need to make it efficient. And if it's not efficient, we don't want to do it. We don't want to waste our time. So that's what we're working on this year. That's one of the big things we're working on this year is getting on top of everything. and making all the warehouses basically meticulous. We want one warehouse that is just ridiculous with stock, and the rest of it we want highly organized, neat and tidy, you know?
Absolutely. I've kind of been dying to ask you this question for a long time, is that I know Amazon is kind of brand new in Australia. It's not built out the way it is here. But and I know it gets brought up on the calls, and sometimes people say, send in a box, see what happens. I don't know if this is true, but if I could go back 10 years and get into Amazon 10 years ago, get into Amazon 15 years ago, and kind of be first to market, the big dog on the block would be such a humongous advantage. Do you, why not Amazon in the first place? Because they can store your stuff, send it out for you. Why not Amazon, period? Or do you not think Amazon will get fully built out? Because I'm telling you, if every single American can go back 15 years and be first to market on Amazon, they would do it.
Yeah.
And Amazon moved in there for a reason. They moved in there to dominate the market. They're not just gonna pity patter over there. So just like your thoughts on that subject, because I hear it come up, and I always think if I can go back 15 years and be first to market, the biggest of whatever niche, you would be reaping the benefits today, 15 years later.
Jeff Bezos, very smart operator. And Amazon, the way they opened in Australia was a real letdown. And we thought that was going to come in and dominate straight away. Their opening for the first 5 or 6 years was like, are these guys serious? Like, they're not doing a great deal. It's a really good place to buy stuff. I don't think it's great to sell stuff. So we know booksellers that have got 30,000 books on eBay, on Amazon, and they sell one a day. And I'm like, righto, well, that's not good, man. That's pretty bad. Like, if you're only selling one a day out of 30,000, this is not for us.
Is that the seller's or the buyer's fault? Is Amazon just not ubiquitous enough to get more than one sale a day if you have 30,000 units, or?
I think I don't blame the seller for that because all I can do is put the items up. And you don't know. It's a gamble. You don't know if it's going to sell or not.
And I'm just asking because I don't know the Amazon exposure in Australia.
I mean, people have heard of Amazon, and more people are gravitating towards it, I think. It is increasing, but it's been very anticlimactic and very slow to take off. You know, they're a big, rich company. They're a logistics company. They're experts in those fields. But it's like, if I was Amazon, and I was opening in Australia, I'd go look at eBay. Who are the big sellers? All right, let's invite them to the platform. Let's reach out to them and see if they want to come on board. And I think they've done that, but I think they've done that with the big new sellers, the people that sell all the brand new stuff and the huge companies, the companies that work on the 10 cents per item profit model and just do huge volume. I don't think they've reached out to people like us. Like, we're a big seller, but we're still a small fish in the pond. And I
Is
think,
the Australian culture acceptable of something like Amazon? Because in the United States, Amazon is the end all be all. It's no one cares. They just go on Amazon and they buy. Is there a cultural difference, perhaps, or no?
not really. We're very Americanized in a lot of ways. And say you go back maybe 20 years ago, we would be, say, maybe 10 years behind trends in America. So whatever was big in America, 10 years later, it'd be huge here, you know? Things like basketball or some things were quicker. Hip-hop culture, you know, we were quick to embrace that. With Amazon, I think people are savvy enough if they want to buy something, the savvy sellers aren't just looking on Amazon or looking on eBay. They're Googling it and they're looking at price points. They're looking, all right, well, I can get this same item on eBay, it's this price or it's cheaper on Amazon, therefore I'll buy it on Amazon. As far as secondhand goes, I mean, we haven't looked at it, we haven't dabbled in it, we thought about it, but it's my understanding is selling to Amazon, you've got to do it their way, and it's their way or the highway, and they're difficult to deal with, and there is no flexibility at
At
all.
times, yeah.
And if we were going to do it, and we will at some point do it, but what I'd do is I would get someone that was an Amazon expert to come and work with us. and say, right, we'll either do a profit share or you'll just work for us. And this is your job role. You've got to learn this and you've got to look after the whole Amazon side of the business. And then just go for that as well. I think a lot of the sellers, a lot of the sellers that sell brand new items, they're not just selling on eBay in Australia. They're selling on eBay and Amazon and got a
Right.
website called Catch and a whole
Right.
bunch of different websites. And all they're doing is putting more fish and more hooks in the
Sure.
pot.
Just increasing the quantity.
But for us to do what we're doing already and then do Amazon on top of that, I mean, maybe once we get the software going and we've got all this free time, but at this point, it's just too much work. And it's, I don't want that. I like stress and I feed off it, but I don't want that additional stress. I don't want the stress of dealing with what I view as another eBay, huge organization that at any point can just stomp on you, you know?
Yeah,
So.
but also on the flip side of the coin, you could build a huge business and maybe they never stomp on you. So like, if it's a good opportunity, we have to jump on it and deal what happens when it happens. That's how I, have looked at it. What do you foresee the biggest bottlenecks with listing 10,000 items a day?
Straight off the bat, everything we list, we put photos up of. We don't use stock images.
I was going to ask you that. With the software, 1,000 items, you're going to still do photos or switch to stock images?
It'll be both. And the reason it'll be both, for us to do photos of 1,000 items and upload them and edit them and do start to finish the photography process, it's about 10 hours. So I've got one person that does that. And he's my right-hand man, and he's wearing a lot of different hats in this business. And I'm lucky to have him. He said to me very early on, he goes, I'm going to need another photographer. And I was just jokingly saying, no, you're just going to have to work a lot more, you know? But if he tells me he needs extra help, like he's serious. And it's like, all right. So all we're doing with this software is we're moving the bottleneck from here over to here, and we're creating a whole bunch of new bottlenecks. You know, and it's not just the photos, it's the put away as well. You've got to think about this stuff. So it
And
goes
then
back to.
even increase picking, increase sales, like putting 1,000 items a day is no joke.
I think we'll gamify it a bit and we'll see, we'll push it to the limit. We'll see what we can do. We'll go, all right, the first day we're going to use this, we're going to put 10,000 listings up to prove it to ourselves and to prove it to other people. Because a lot of people are like, nah, you need to stop buying. The software's not going to work. You're dreaming. You're crazy. You're delusional. I'm like, calm
No,
down.
I believe you could do it.
Of
And
course we can do it. It's
yeah,
easy.
I believe so.
It
Let
takes
me
2 seconds to scan something.
so are you do actual photos of all of your listings or a stock photo?
So
I
at the
like that.
minute, with the software, the way we've got it set up is this. So we do the listings. And it automatically goes up with either if a stock image comes up, that's there. Otherwise, we've got a placeholder photo, which is just our business logo. And then what we do is the box goes from the lister to the photographer. He takes the photos, uploads them, then the box gets put away. In the meantime, a lot of the time, it might sit there for a day or two waiting for photos. Items will sell out of that box because it's the right title, it's the right price, everything's on point, but we don't have photos of it. So you don't necessarily need photos if the market is strong enough. A lot of our competitors use stock photos only. The world's biggest sellers are using stock photos. I disagree with that, but I
I do
understand
too.
why they do it.
Yeah,
So what
I
we're
do
going to
too.
do with 1,000 or 10,000 listings a day, the software will automatically put in a stock image. If there's no stock image available, it'll put in our placeholder photo. And then what we'll do is we will go back and take the actual photos and upload them. But we're going to get an additional staff member to help do that. And there might be a 1 week delay before photos go up. If we're doing 1,000 a day, there'll become this backlog. So we
Right.
will prioritize putting the photos up. But if it's an item we're selling very cheap, you know, we may not need to. It may just sell automatically in the meantime.
So I personally don't like stock photos as a seller and also as a buyer. I think it's a better customer experience to have a photo, a real photo, Let not a computer generated photo. I'm totally turned off by that as a buyer. But do you think it's important to have a photo of the actual item the customer will receive, or can you guys develop your own stock photos? Let's say Metallica CD, you're going to list it 100 times this year. Could you use the same one so long as if it's in the same condition? Or do you think that the buyer should get the actual photograph of the actual item that they will receive?
Both.
Yeah, because your software, you can integrate, we've already taken this Metallica CD 100, we already did 100 times. This is our stock photo for this CD.
So with the software, it doesn't just do listing. It's a fairly useful back-end tool. So one thing it does is it identifies from the barcode if we've already got this item listed. And then what we can do is we can look to consolidate. If we've got 20 copies of the same item listed and they're all the same, exactly the same, we can consolidate those into one listing. And what we say, we've got a disclaimer on our listings that says if we've got one copy of this item, the photo is of the actual item. If we've got multiples, it is considered a stock image. It is an actual photo of what we're selling, but they may get that copy or they may get the copy next to it. The only time we change is we do sell to a lot of collectors. They want the original case. They want the case if it's broken. They still want the original. And they might be looking for things like certain stickers on cases. I don't know if you can see these stickers. Now, if we've got two copies of this CD, one's got a sticker, a special sticker on it, the other one doesn't, that's two separate listings because the photos of the item don't represent what the buyer will be getting. So it's got to match 100%. So we do both. We do essentially what you'd call an actual photo that essentially is a stock image. And we also have photos of the exact item. It depends also on the value of it. If it's a $500 CD, regardless of if two look exactly the same, it's going to be the one listed.
Absolutely. So what how do you navigate this one has a sticker, so we need actual photos of this. Is it just due to the experience of this sticker matters, so we're going to photograph that? Because you have no idea if the one in the inventory has a sticker or not.
So what we do is we do a lot of things like we do consolidations and we do things called zeros to ones. So a zero to one is because what we used to do is we just used to list everything. We didn't used to check to see if we already had it listed. We just automatically list it, you know? And the rationale behind that was the actual photographed item is what you'll be receiving. So it's exactly as it is photographed. And that was a good selling point for us for a long time. But it's not as sustainable. So what we do now is if we've got one exact item and we've sold it and it's gone from one in stock to zero, what we'll do is we'll go and see if we've got an exact copy and everything matches, and then we can just change the SKU on that listing and make it a one in stock. And it's better for the algorithm, I think, because you're saying to eBay, we've already proven we've
Sales
successfully sold
history.
this. Now we've got it back in stock. So it's been a powerful tool for us as well, and that's helped generate additional sales.
So you have like very, very high expectations for what you're doing. If you list one a day, it's going to be perfect. You list 100 a day, you start giving in a little bit to some things here and there. At 1,000 a day or 10,000 a day, what concessions are you going to have to make as far as quality goes to make sure that you're able to do this? Because in the beginning we all write a handwritten note, thank you very much, but at some time it's not sustainable to do. Do you think you can still maintain the same exact high quality at 1,000 a day?
Easy.
Really?
Easy, man. Easy peasy. So with our listings, a long time ago, we wanted to follow everything eBay told us to do. So with the item specifics came in, we used to list a box of CDs, 80 CDs, listed, priced, researched, photographed, start to finish, the whole process in 45 minutes, right? That's pretty quick. When they brought in the item specifics, that 45-minute task ballooned to 3 hours. That's how much longer it took. We don't see the importance of saying what series a DVD is when it's a movie. but it's still one of the item specifics you've got to put in there. We don't see the importance of, unless it's a limited edition special colored vinyl record, putting what color is the CD in the item
Sure.
specifics. So
Sure.
what I said to the software guys is, we know what eBay wants, but we also know what we want and what's feasible and workable and what our buyers expect. And the item specifics it automatically fills out are the artist, the title, the condition, and all that sort of important stuff. We ignore the other item specifics that we don't think are relevant, because what's the point of putting in false information?
Absolutely.
And it's like, all right, so straight off the bat, we're not doing it 100% as a lot of people would. So what we used to do to get rid of all the item specifics, if we didn't have an answer to the question, we'd put an X in there or NA, but that's the wrong thing to do as well. So we've just had to learn with, we're going to have a warning on the eBay page saying, you need to fill out this amount of item specifics. So the listing side of it's taken care of. The title, we can at any point, we scan the barcode, it automates all this process, it fills in all this data for us. But at the same time, we can manually go in there very quickly and easily straight away and add information or subtract information if we need to. The listing process isn't going to be the bottleneck. The quality control, checking the CD matches the case, it's not too scratched, everything's good. That is a longer process, much longer than the listing process, then the photography process. And that's quick as well, man. Like, we're talking 8 seconds for three photos. It's super quick. Our system for taking photos is beautiful, and it's so quick and easy. And we've done things like special lighting and special. We've got a camera on a. It's a. It's called a copy table, and it's a tri. Essentially, it's a tripod arm that sits straight up on a bit of wood. We've got a jig on that wood where we perfectly can place a CD or a DVD and get a perfect photo every time. We've got a remote control connected to the camera, so you don't have to reach up and press the button and move the camera slightly and shake it. And then we've got a screen where it's plugged into the camera and you can see the photo you've just taken. Like,
Very
we've gone
cool.
to the nth degree to make it as
Very
quick
cool.
and easy as possible, So our photos are on point most times, and it's super quick and easy. The bottleneck isn't in taking the photos. The bottleneck is my right-hand man, Aaron, standing there all day taking the photos. You can't do that to people. They're not machines. I did say to him a long time ago, we were going to replace him with a robot. And we actually spoke to a robotics division at a university about a machine that can automate taking the photos. And they can
Yeah.
do it, man. It'll be $50,000, but they'll also write a grant application for us on our behalf. And then it'll only cost us $20,000. I'm like, all right, this is pretty good. But Aaron liked taking photos back then, and he was upset. He's like, oh, well, don't replace me with a robot. I'm like, well, but maybe now's the time, because he doesn't want to stand
Maybe.
there for 8 hours a day, 10 hours a day
Right.
taking photos.
Right. And $20,000 is not even a full-time employee for the whole year, and you got a robot for life. So maybe you might be going robots over there, Tom. All right, Tom,
Well,
I don't know how much time you got to spend with me, but I'm enjoying the conversation. I just have maybe a couple more questions because every time you talk, I just have more and more questions. So at some point, you just have to stop talking. If you can list so many items so quickly, so easily, how are you not going to fall into the trap of just buying stuff for the sake of buying it because it's so easy to list and you end up having a 300,000 item store of stuff that now you're just storing? Or do you have to be very, very cognizant of, I still have to maintain my quality standards, even though I see this entire room and I know we can get all of this stuff listed in 45 days, but not all of it is good enough. Because I for me, that could be a trap. Oh, I could list all this stuff. It doesn't mean it's ever going to sell, but I'll store it forever.
The idea behind that is, if you've got 500,000 items of unlisted inventory, how do you tackle that problem? And I think one way to tackle it is to go through it as much as you can, work out what's worth listing, what's not, but get it listed. We do not know what is going to sell and what isn't. So to me, you're better off listing more, seeing what sells, And if you've got to change up in a year's time and it hasn't sold, and either liquidate something or pull it out or bundle it together with something else, but now we've got a database for us to do a bundle, we can search our database and find stuff to bundle it together. That makes more sense. The idea is to get on top of our game, get everything sorted out, and then look more at your approach and the way you do things and the way you preach and go, all right, is this feasible for us at this scale? Yes or no. But what I do is this. I look at what you preach and I look at what is taught in the group and I go, that's good. We like that. We'll take a bit of that. And then someone else does something a little bit different and go, I like that. We'll try that. Your approach is very good. It's a very logical, smart, simplistic approach. And it is essentially, in my mind, it's a numbers game. If this doesn't have the potential to make this amount of money, I'm not going to buy it to put it in my store. I want to maintain a level of quality. At the same time, we are gobsmacked every day at some of the stuff we sell. We're like, why would someone buy this Australian country music yodeling CD? But people go crazy for this stuff. And I'm like, we learned long ago, you cannot buy stuff that you like just sell that. You've got to buy and cater to basically all these different types of people that want all this different type of stuff. So when we started listing books, we knew nothing about books. So instead of trying to work it out, we just started listing everything and seeing what works and what doesn't. And from that experience, we're honing our skills and we're learning, okay, this stuff sells, this does not. We'll buy more of this, we'll buy less of that and keep it going. So the idea is get on top of everything we've got here, list as much as possible. You cannot sell anything that you don't have listed. If it doesn't sell, so be it. But then when we're buying stuff, it's either got to be a good bulk lot at the right price and make sense, or it's got to be based on my experience and my knowledge. We know this is good, therefore we'll buy it. And we do a bit of both. We buy bulk lots and we buy a full collection. We take out the best stuff, we liquidate the less desirable, and we also go and headhunt and go, yep, that's good, we'll buy that. That's good, we'll buy that. So we do a bit of both. But the trap, I mean, there's a lot of traps in this business, and it's just a case of what do you want to do? Where do you want to take it? How do you want to do it? And you just got to work with it, man. Like you got to, we learn a lot by trial and error. Like we know we're not perfect, but we try stuff and we try it hard and we see what works and what doesn't. If it works, we continue it. If it doesn't work, we don't, you know? But I think you're never going to have a perfect, I don't think you're ever really going to have a perfect model because circumstances happen, things change, you know?
For sure, 100%. So with the mass listing approach, part of the thing after that that you mentioned was that you'll have time and your staff will have time to do more of the intelligent tasks, which you guys don't have time to do or as much time to do today with doing everything manually. So one of the intelligent tasks that you guys will do is go through the inventory and assess at a given time, we've had this for too long. And then either have that $1 sale that you were talking about, make a job lot, put it on a pallet, figure out a different way for those items. That's the plan.
Yeah, what we're going to do is so we the first idea is to get on top of all the unlisted inventory and increase our listings to 250,000. By doing so, we should automatically make more money because we've got more items available for sale, and
Absolutely.
we've also got more. It's quicker and easier for us to move around the warehouse. The less clutter you have, the more money you can make. There is a direct correlation to that, you know, and it is as simple as. I can move from this area to this area without having to walk around 35 boxes. Therefore, it's quicker. Therefore, I can do more work. Therefore, I'm going to make more money, you know? And it's what it is. Oh, I've lost my train of thought.
It's okay. We're talking about intelligent task and getting
Yeah.
rid of the items that you've had for a time that you've assessed too long at that time.
So what we're going to do is this. We're going to set up a new, we moved our packing area from one side of the warehouse to the other because we needed to double its size and we needed to have better systems. So at where the packing area was, we had a little door, like a pedestrian door, to take bags out to a vehicle to take to the post office. So we're scaling up, so we needed a loading dock. So now we can open a massive door and walk straight out of a loading dock and straight into a vehicle and off it goes. It is only a small saving of time, but because we repeat it so many times, it's worth doing. From that area, we have the packing area. What we're going to do is put a new shelf up. And then once we're on top of the death pile, or once we've got those 2 hours a day extra to spend on more intelligent tasks, we're going to move every single box in our warehouse in the CD area across to this new shelf. And as we move it across, we're putting a new label on it, the same SKU, but a new label to indicate we've gone through it. What we're going to do is basically start over. All right, this stuff's been listed for 7 years. It hasn't sold. Why hasn't sold? Is it bad quality? Is it a bad title? Is the price wrong? Are the photos shit? What do we need to do? So we're going to do a stock take on everything, which is a horrible task. But we're not just doing a stock take. Essentially, we're going to start over with these listings and go, right, it hasn't sold. Why hasn't it sold? And redo it. And at that point, we'll consolidate a lot of stuff and we'll pull a lot of stuff out and go, right, this is damaged. We shouldn't have listed this. This isn't even something we should be selling. We'll pull it out altogether. So we're going to balloon our listings to 250,000, but then we're going to go back from the start and start over and do quality control and go, right, what do we need to do to get this out the door? Or should we not be selling it? And then we're going to go all the way through. So that'll probably take us. That's a big job, man. That's
That's
bigger than
huge,
doing the
Joe.
listings from start. It's
So,
big.
do you mean starting over, you're going to take your store to zero and relist everything? Or you said you're going to go to 250 and then start back from the beginning?
So we go to 250 and then we go back to that first box and we pull everything out and we do the whole process again. So we do quality control, we check the photos, we check the listing, we check the title, we check everything. It's essentially redoing the listing. It would actually be quicker and easier for us just to end all those listings and relist and start over. But it's a bit of a punishment and it's a bit of a learning curve and it's a hard way to do it. And it's not just me doing it, it's my guys doing it as well. So it's about me also teaching my guys on how we do it, what we do, what we don't do. And it's like, all right, it's going to be hard. But it's like you said to Mel a long time ago, and this really stuck with me. She's had the virus in a store. She's overbought. She's got all this stuff everywhere. Her systems are really bad. And then she's got to do the punishment. So we'll do the punishment, but it'll be on a much grander scale because we've got so much more to deal with and we've got more people to do it. But it's a big job.
Because if you take the starting date or the new birthday of your company when you get this software fully dialed in and you can list 1,000 a day, like you said, maybe even capable of 10,000 a day, why wouldn't you take your store down to zero and spend 13 days and relist the entire store? And that way it's totally right from the beginning, a fresh start, and then you jump into the death pile.
We sell every day, we sell items that have been listed as long as 5, 7 years. It would be detrimental to us, I think, to do it that way. I think. I don't know, but it's such a horrible task and a horrible thing to think about. I'm like, all right, I'm not going to bury my head in the sand, but we need to work out the best way of tackling it. But I think if we're doing 2,000 or 1,000 listings a day and we're doing a pick and pack, and then on top of that, we're ending 10,000 listings and redoing it, I think we'd need a lot more staff to do that. And I don't think that's the right way of doing it. I think having that much movement in the store, having 10,000 listings go up and 10,000 listings go down, might be overdoing it. I'm even nervous about doing as many 10,000 listings a day. Because I'm like, well, maybe eBay won't like that. Like we've got to sort of slowly, potentially slowly ramp it up to 10,000. We might have to start on 1,000 a day. At this point, the most listings we've ever done is 1,200 in one day.
You're not going to come out the gate and just do 10,000. You're going to slow because things are going to break. It's going to get complicated. Like you don't know what to expect. 10,000 is a lot, Tom.
We are set up right now. We've got 20,000 items that have been quality controlled that are sitting there ready next to a computer, next to two computers, with space for two more computers. So we could have four people in there. We've got roller conveyors set up. So someone can sit at the computer and they get up and they move 1 meter, mainly so they're not twisting while they're in the chair because it's bad for your back. And they put the box in the roller conveyor and it rolls off to the photography area. We've got the boxes set. We've got everything set up to do straight away as soon as we get it to smash it straight away with 10,000, and that's what we're going to try and do because I want to prove it to people like Thomas in the group and Shane in the group. These guys are like, nah, you're dreaming, you're crazy, you're delusional. All right, am I delusional or am I just more imaginative than potentially you are? You know, you've got your way of viewing your business. But now, welcome to Australia style. This is how we do things, you know. Like, there's a bit of bravado and a bit of back and forth, you know. And I enjoy it. I feed off that.
And yeah, it's great conversations both ways. And like I said, like I love listening to it. All right, you have 250,000 listings. Will you be happy?
No, of course not. Of course not. Why would I be happy at that point?
You tell me. It's 250,000 listings. That's something to be proud of, something to be happy with. You won't be content with that?
No, of course not. I'm already super proud of the operation, but I'm proud of my guys, and I'm proud of what we've achieved. I'm not proud of my input, and I'm not proud of what I've done, and I never will be. Like I'm sort of almost happy, but in my mind, the job is not done. It's nowhere near being done. We've got, in this industry, there are so many problems and there are so many silly things that go on. And the things I'm worried about are huge corporations coming in and going, right, we're going to close all the Goodwills down. We are Goodwill. And all we're going to do is sell online now. You know, the future of this is big corporations coming in and decimating all these small sellers.
And
so it's
doing
like,
100,000 a day, everything's a penny.
Well, that's right. You know, yeah. And it's like, all right, so I'll be happy when I'm happy with the operation. And to me, what we are now is we're the tip of the iceberg, right? The iceberg is very big. So we're like at 1% of where we need to be. So I've got a lot of work to do. And I'm talking about a lifetime worth of work. Like, this is not something that's going to be done next year. Mm-hmm. You know, if we are at a point where I can pay my top guys, you know, seven figures and go, we are making so much money. You've worked so hard in this organization. You deserve the best reward I can possibly give you. You know, as a token of the appreciation, this is what I'm paying you. You're getting paid more than I am. My guys get paid more than I do now. Because all my money goes back into the business, you know, and I want to keep it that way. I feel like if people are loyal and they stick by you, you have to reward that. What makes me happy is I come up, the company comes up, my guys come up, we bring more people in, and we make a positive change that benefits a whole bunch of people. I've got a huge problem with op shops or thrift shops. So we've got two main op shops or thrift shops in Australia. They're both run by the church. And a lot of the money they receive, one of them is based overseas, and a lot of that money goes overseas, which I think is wrong. So people in Australia are donating to a charity because they think it's going to benefit people that are not as well off in our country. There is an element of that, but that element's not big enough. These guys are like, all right, we'll make sure we've all got flash cars and all the best new gear and our shops look incredible and we spend all this huge money on decking out these shops. And then the homeless people that we're trying to support don't get as much. It's skew-if. And I think if we can come up with an organisation, and I thought about it once and I'm like, if we were, we'd call it like actually helping. And what I'd do is I'd say, right, instead of if we operated a charity shop and we had donations coming in, we would process them and sell them cheaply because we don't want to store the stuff. We want quick in, quick out. But what we want to do is we want to have, instead of going to another company to buy logistics equipment like trolleys and special baskets and stuff, we would find someone that might be struggling, train them up on how to use a welder, give them the skills to implement themselves, get them to build this equipment for us. So I see a lot of holes in the market across the board, from eBay to op shops, all across the board. And I go, how can this be done better, not just from a monetary point of view, but for a society point of view? Because I'm not in it. And this is, again, why I'm dangerous to other people. because I'm not in it just for the money. That's not what my motivation is. My motivation is much bigger than that. I want to leave this earth with having made a positive impact. That's what I'm passionate about doing. So it's like, all right, so we're not looking on, getting our sell-through rate through the roof so we can all, drive around in Bugattis. We want to build something so at the end of our life, we can look back and go, all right, I'm really proud of that. That's what we want.
So, what in your business are you really proud about today?
Look, I really look at it and I look at the warehouse and I look at the level of organization. I go, I'm really happy with how nice and straight these shelves are and how well organized this is, how neat and tidy it is, how professional it is. And I'm proud of that. And I'm proud of where we started and where we've come to. Because it's been hard, man. Like, it is not. People that think this business is easy, they're the delusional ones, man. Like, this is not a walk in the park. Like, I look at this and I go, man, if we wanted an easy life and to make a lot of money, this is not the way to do it. Like, this is a hard slog. And that's what I'm proud of. I'm proud of where we started and where we've come to. But I'm also realistic in knowing I'm not satisfied. I'm still super hungry. And I'm hungrier. It ebbs and flows. Like, I lost my mojo a little while ago because all these software systems were taking longer and costing more money. And I'm telling people they're coming because I'm being told they're coming. And then something happens and they're not here yet. We know it's working. It's been tested. We've tested it. We've seen it. But it's not 100%. And these guys want to give us that ready product. But the thing is, if it was easy, everyone would do it. If it was something that you could just do overnight, everyone would do it. It's hard, man. And it's hard to achieve this high level stuff. And once you achieve it, that's where you can look back and go, that was worth the stress. And I'm proud of this. And this is good. But then use that momentum to go, let's do something bigger and better. Momentum is a very strong tool for us. Negativity can be a very strong tool for us. Like, when certain guys from the group criticize me, I get empowered. I'm like, well, I'll prove you guys wrong, And it's like, if you can use that in a positive way, it's a powerful tool. It's like anger. If you're angry, like, if I get angry at eBay and go, I've got a negative feedback, now I'm going to go off and do 10,000 listings, and you put a positive spin on it, you can use that negativity in a positive way. And I think that's a powerful tool as well. And I'm proud of that sort of stuff. I'm proud of problems come in, how we deal with it, how quickly we deal with it and move on. And that's the stuff I'm proud of.
Tom, I could talk to you all day. I appreciate you coming in on Sunday in Australia talking to me. Any last words to leave the people with? I have thoroughly enjoyed this conversation. This has been the most challenging conversation I've had so far in a very good way, because I knew when I started this recording I had to bring my A game. And it's been an absolute joy to talk to you today, Tom.
Well, thank you. I'm glad, as I said at the start, I'm glad that you appreciate and other people appreciate the work that goes into it. And sometimes it's enough to say to people, oh, you're an eBay seller. I sell on eBay too. How many listings you got? And they're gobsmacked, And I mean, we're an open book, man. Like, I've had people in op shops go, what sort of money do you make? And I just showed them our 90-day total. And there's no bluff there, man. I'm saying, this is where we're at. And they're just gobsmacked. But they don't understand there's all the behind the scenes overheads and stuff that goes on. It's harder than people think.
Yes.
And I think it's one of these things. There's a lot of power working together. And I would urge anyone, if they've got competitors that are nice people that you can work with in one way or the other, I'm not saying partner up, but I'm saying maybe help each other. There is more power in doing that than just competing with each other. And I think if all resellers banded together, some pretty big, powerful stuff could be achieved. And I think this is something that people need to think about. Don't just hide everything from everyone else. Don't just be selfish. Think about what you can do to better what we're doing, for everyone's benefit, the buyer, the seller, the platform, everything. And that's probably the last thing I'd like to say.
I appreciate it, Tom. Thank you very much for tuning in with us today. It has been an absolute honor. Thank you, my
Thanks,
man.
Dick.
Be
Appreciate it.
great.
Thank you.
Thank you.